Hi, this is the 18th of June 2017, recording this just before the big match for the day. And so let me just get down to it. This is one of the charts that I had put out, tweeted on, and essentially looking at this falling channel for the last 9 days. It's been a long pattern. And we had many of these patterns essentially from the low that we saw in April, and from there on, each move is part of a fifth wave, and then you get this consolidation, which could have been a topping structure. Once again, we saw that at the May high, and that has again repeated from the June high. So every month we are seeing a short rally which lasts a couple of days, and then this long consolidation phase. Once again, we are at the lower end of a rising channel from April. If you just take the highs and lows together. And that's closer to 95.50. So unless we really break that, we should be heading once again to the upper end of this channel is what this chart would say. Now, what has been particularly unusual about the corrections that we've seen this far, I'm looking at a chart of one of the many sentiment indicators that you can watch. This one is, of course, the position. Many of you may be tracking it, the FII position, if you just cumulatively sum and plot the FI and client positions on a daily basis, they essentially become significantly long, near meaningful tops. So what's unusual has been that when you look at this data going all the way back, so I'm going to scroll you through the data readings from 2012 onwards, and you can see, and that's when they started publishing it, that every time you've reached the red line or crossed above it and then fallen back below. We've had several important highs, which is one of the reasons I look at it. And you can see this high here, which was nearly close to 5,600, 5,700, and you came all the way back to 4,700. So that's almost 1,000 points over a 3 to 4 month period, nearly a 20% correction. So my point of highlighting this is when you really scroll through it and just look at the blue data point hitting the red line every time we've gotten there. We've got these deep cuts. The only difference is that these deep cuts have reduced in percentage. So what was, you know, a 15% kind of correction then became 10. Then when we moved into 2014, it came down to around 8%. You know, so all these highs that we are seeing here, each of them got followed by not more than a 7-8% correction, and then the market could pull back up again. And then we move into this year where we look at 2016, and we actually got smaller moves. Each of these highs here, you got a high reading and you got not more than a 4 to 5% pullback. So when I come back to this chart, this is more updated to up to May, and then you again have this reading. So when you come to into 2017, the pullbacks are now down to not even 2%. That's all we got in April of this month, of this year. And so that was significantly small, and it essentially shows you the same thing that we've been noting in volatility indices, that volatility has been contracting ever since 2010-11 onwards, and that contraction is showing up in smaller and smaller pullbacks, as, especially in each of the last years on the same sentiment readings. But that does not mean that the internal technical picture of the market is not deteriorating, because as we are getting into the advanced stage of this move, we are seeing reduced breadth, weaker breadth at each stage. We are seeing lower volumes, especially in June at the highs. I think they were, you know, at almost a 3-4 month low in volumes. And you're also seeing, so you're seeing very little participation by a narrow list of stocks that is taking the market each time to a high. So you really need to be careful about where you're in. And some of these sectors that were participating earlier are not participating anymore. In fact, into the June high, I think the PSU banks were high on spirits, and suddenly they have given up from there. So I've actually written about that. This is a chart of the CNX PSU bank index, and this clearly shows, the lower tops that the index has made. It almost touched this upper line, which would be a meaningful resistance range. And from there, my sense is that most probably looking at the individual public sector bank stocks, because this one closer reflects State Bank of India, which is the big name. But when you look at the individual pairs, they have actually made much lower tops over this period. And some of them are closer to this lower line as well. So this move is complete in most cases, I think, as an X or character wave, and Z, which would be the most significant last wave down, is what should have already started for this sector. So but still it's surprising that this, it's a lot in the news for all the wrong reasons. And every time there's any news item related to the public sector banks, you find them spiking up, 4, 5, 6% on any particular day. And sometimes the news itself doesn't make sense, if you ask me, because what is that news? That news is essentially about getting all these banks to merge together. Now, while that might sound sensible, it's essentially a postponement strategy in my mind, because it's very clear that the size of these losses are pretty significant. They are big. And there are only a couple of ways around this problem. One is that you could simply finance the banks, and that would mean that their capital reduces significantly. Now, by merging a weak bank with a stronger one, you're essentially trying to hide those losses temporarily. I say that because those losses are essentially being transferred from one bank to the next. The next bank's capital would start getting written down, but simply because the next bank has lower NPA ratios at that point of time, or better capital ratios, it would essentially, for the time being, show a lower loss and be able to wait a little longer before it actually comes up for refinancing. And so it's essentially buying time to refinance your capital, because if you had to refinance it right away, being a public sector institution, you'd have to go to the government and get that funding right on. Otherwise, the bank would almost be insolvent, with most of its balance sheet being cleaned out by those losses, because the book value would simply go to zero or negative in some cases. So that's what is being thought out, and it's essentially a postponement strategy, not a solution to the problem. And you still have the issues related to moral hazard that do not come as being addressed. Of course, the good news is that the government's pushing for the corporations to the big ones that have the big loans to actually come clean. But it's already taken so long that many of these loans can't really be sorted out. The losses that would have to be taken for each of them are still going to be pretty large. If you've read the reading, is essentially looking at companies where 60% of the debt was already considered bad. I'm sure the ratio is higher, and a lot of it is turned bad because interest payments cannot be made, or rather the interest payments were converted into debt year after year, and the size just kept getting bigger. And in the meantime, you're dealing with 10 institutions, which is only 25% of the reported bad loans. The rest of the 75% are accumulating more interest costs as well. And of course, there are those with new NPAs that will get reported over this period of time. So it just doesn't get anywhere unless you simply press the button and do it all at once. And if you don't do that, you're simply wasting time, because the much needed positive mood in the banking industry towards lending and credit that has to come on is really missing, because sentiment has turned negative, and a lot of the authorities are not willing to take the required action. So I think when the PSU banks actually bounce back each time, now that this trend is actually technically complete, each time it's a counter trend move, gives one more selling opportunity. None of the news is really positive in terms of the long term development. It's of course means that yes, you end it to the right end, that is, you are sorting the problem, but it doesn't really sort it today, which means that the troubles are still there for these banks, and they don't become buys on that day just because they are spiking up. And so that's the point, that they have far more downside from here till we reach the end point where you're actually replenishing capital, and that's when you'll come to know what's the real book value and real position of each of these banks and be able to value them correctly from there on. So that's still a time away. I would only hope that they complete that process faster than later, so that you can get on with the real economy. Lastly, let me also cover the dollar a bit, because I've been pretty outspoken about my views on the dollar. I think a long-term top is in, but you might just be witnessing one of the first possible bounce backs. So you need a little more confirmation for that, but it's possible that we just completed the first wave down and should be bouncing back. Of course, there are internal subdivisions, but we might have sort of five wave decline there. And so this entire rise of the dollar from 2008 to 2017 have marked as ABC, where the fifth is complete, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, at exactly 66% of the previous bear market. And so we've resumed the bear market for the dollar. That's my sense. What we might be seeing here, though, is after this triangular formation, right at the highs, we've actually made the first five wave dip and are probably bouncing back. So the question really is, how much you're going to retrace, how much time are you going to take, and that would provide some relief to the weak dollar environment. At the same time, it puts pressure on things like precious metals. And once that counter trend move is done, once we've had that bounce back, I think the trend down for the dollar would again resume. So that's what I'm going to be watching out for in the days ahead. Now, one of the most direct impacts that you would have from the dollar would be on the dollar USD INR rate, and you've not really seen much movement in the USD INR, but the direct impact of the USD INR is essentially on the currency weighted return. And so I'm just looking at a chart of the Dollex, and there's also an interesting chart. I don't know if these markings turn out to be true, but if you look at the high made in 2010-2015, you stretch that trend line all the way to where we are today, then we are very, very close to kissing this upper line. We didn't do so yet, but one more push higher, the level would be closer to 4030. So once the Dollex 30, that's the dollar-based Sensex, hits 4030, you would have actually touched this line that has been stretching from all the previous tops, which essentially looks like a large triangle as of now, unless you break past it. But I would really look for some kind of resistance and selling pressure coming in at that level. So I think that's the last and final chart from me today. And till the next time, good luck and have a great day.